Good morning. My name's Megan. On behalf of the worship team, we're glad that you're with us this morning in worship. I'd like for you to stand and let's all sing together.
Everybody falls sometimes. Gotta find the strength to rise from the ashes and make a new beginning. Anyone can feel the ache. You think it's more than you can take, but you're stronger, stronger than you know. And don't you give up now. The sun will soon be shining. You gotta face the clouds to find the silver lining.
Become You may be seated. Welcome to worship. All right. What?
Somebody had a birthday.
Oh, man.
Recently. So I would like to ask everyone to join me in singing someone happy birthday today.
Aww.
All right, you ready?
I don't know if I have enough air to blow this candle out.
Well, it's only one. We didn't put all of them on there. We had to make you feel like you're your age that you're at. Right?
Thank you. Yeah. What age am I at?
One.
That's how I act sometimes, but you know.
All right, yeah. Ready? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Troy. Happy birthday to you.
Thank you.
Big wish. I'll put it on your desk.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. You guys are awesome. Thank you. Yeah, I won't remember this day. That's the age I'm at right now. It's just great to be with you all. My name is Troy Mercil. For those of you who do not know me, I am your pastor here at First Washington. It is great to be with you. If this is your first time here, welcome. We're so glad that you're here. I want to meet you. I'll be out in the lobby right after this, so I would love to meet up with you and say hi and get your blood type and stuff like that. No, I won't do any of that. But I just want to say hi and just talk. That's all right with you guys. So love to meet you out in the lobby. A couple things that I want to go over. We're going to start shortening up the message time as far as the highlights, the announcement stuff. The reason we are doing that is because we do these bulletins. We encourage you to take these home with you and read through there. There's going to be a lot of things that you all and I can get involved in here at not only at the church but in the community. So please take these home and put them someplace where you can update them and look at them. I'm only going to be doing three or four things. I'm not going to be doing a whole plethora of stuff. But today, after the worship service, we've got the Higher Grounds Coffee House. How many of you knew that we had a coffee house downstairs? 8 of you. Awesome. So now you all know. Afterwards, if you would like to fellowship and meet with some people, this is a great opportunity of going downstairs, having a cup of coffee, just mingling with other people. We do have a kids' playroom set up as well, so if you would like to bring the kiddos down there and just discuss and let them play, it's a great opportunity right after church service. We also see that's what happens whenever you get older. You can't speak anymore. Healthy Vessels Wellness Event. I really encourage you to sign up for that and come. It's going to be a great opportunity. Shannon and Maggie are putting this together, and it's going to be great. If you like to do yoga or if you want to learn how to become healthier with drinks and supplements and stuff like that, that's going to be an opportunity. They're also going to have some other things that are essential oils and stuff. So it's $15. It's going to be held here on April the 6th. From 9 to 11, so that's a Saturday morning. So if you want to come and check that out, that'll be great. We're also going to have the youth group retreat. If you're wanting to sign up for that, if you are a youth 5th grade to 12th grade, please get your paperwork in as soon as you possibly can. Mike and Jennifer are going to be ordering everything. If you would like to be an adult mentor and would like to go, it's going to be a great opportunity. Just make sure that you get your paperwork in by March 31st. Is that correct? Okay, March 31st. So if you're wanting to go, get that in. And then on April the 7th, we're going to have a State of the Church address. This is something we're going to try to do at least two or three times a year to keep us updated on what the ministries are going on here, how you can get involved, the financial piece of what takes place at the church. We're going to have chips and sandwiches right after the church, so we encourage you to stick around and hear that. And we're going to do something that we don't normally do in church, is celebrate the wins. How many times do we stop and just celebrate the wins? And so we're going to be doing that, and I encourage you to stay after on April the 7th. You'll get to hear from every ministry leader. You'll get to hear from our elected officials such as finance, church council, PPR, and our trustees of what's going on here at church. So this is a great opportunity for you to put this on your calendar and get to know what's going on, okay? Those are the messages that I have. Their binders are on the edge of each of your seats. Love for you to fill those out. Again, if you're a first-time guest with us, fill out the, I don't know which side it is. I think it's the right-hand side on that. So just fill that out. Send it down to your neighbor. You'll receive a gift from me after church if you do that, okay? So, and also, if you are on Facebook or any social media and you want to check in, we're getting ready to start a brand new series. You've come at a great time. It's a series called Even If. We're going to be doing this throughout Easter. So I encourage you to just let everything go. Whatever you came in with, whenever you came into this room today, for the next 30 or 40 minutes, just put it on pause. Just focus on what God has in store for you today. I'm going to ask Andrea to come up, and we're going to have all 975 kids join us. And she's going to do the children's message. If you have a prayer request and you would like to fill out that green card that is on the back of your chair and would like to turn those in, we're going to do prayer requests right after the children's message, okay? So if you want to do the prayer request and get those up here, that would be great.
How's it going, guys? I think we do have over 900 kids up here. There's a lot of you today. It's awesome. Over 30. How are we doing today? Did you guys like the more spring-like weather this week? Yes. Did you hear that? I think they've not been that excited for some time now. No. Who loved all the sunshine? Me. That was great. So I just want to quickly talk about, right now we're in the Lenten season. The season. Do you guys know what that is? No. Okay. Go ahead. It's where you take a break from something and for 40 days, and why would we do that? So there's another holiday coming up, and it's, that's right, Easter. So Lent
Easter.
Is what, okay, thank you, dear. Lent is what we celebrate, not celebrate, but that's what we are, the season we're in until Easter, and Easter is when we get to celebrate because Jesus rose from the dead. So I want you to think about, for the next few weeks, until now, until Easter, something that you can give up to help you focus more on God, okay? And sometimes that can be a candy bar, or sometimes that can be fighting with my brother, okay? So little things, or sister, how about that? Or being nicer to someone to help bring you closer to God. So that's what we want to do in Lent. All right, let's put our hands together. Oh, boy. Okay. Close your eyes, hands together. All right. Loving Father, help us to find ways to make time in our lives to come closer to you in this Lenten season so we can prepare for Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Back. Slowly.
Maggie to come up, and if you have any prayer requests that you would like to turn in, please bring those up, or you can hand them. Maggie's right there. She can grab those prayer requests from you. And she's going to do our prayers of the people at this point in time.
I just ask that we would begin a time of prayer. Creator God, we thank you for all the things that we have happening in our life right now. We thank you for the good things and the bad things, the things that are a struggle and the things that are a blessing. We specifically ask right now for prayers to go out to all those who are being affected by the flooding that's been happening all across the Midwest. I ask specifically for prayers for the victims of violence in Christchurch in New Zealand. And I ask for prayers for those who are in our school districts and for those who are in our community who are survivors of violence and poverty and all the things that go unseen and are not so obvious when we drive through town or when we go to the grocery store or when we pick our kids up from school. God, I ask that in this time of Lent, while we're thinking about the things that we give up or the things that we can sacrifice to make more time for you, that we do those things boldly and with intention and with action, that we aren't just giving up something for our own benefit, that we're giving up something to have purpose and to have meaning in our relationship with you. And God, we thank you for all the wonderful things that you do in our life and the things that you place on our heart as opportunities for us to be in community with others. And today we lift up in prayer Jennifer. And Bonnie. And Carla. And the Elbert family. For the Nero family. For Vicky. For Kara. For Diana. For Christina. And for Robin. And for all those names and all those prayers that have not been said out loud, but those prayers that are in our hearts, Creator God, we just lift those up to you to be received by you and for you to show us action on how to help take care of those people that we prayed for today. God, we thank you for the sermon that's about to happen, and we ask that you would be with Troy as he gives this message to our congregation, and I just ask that you would be with us the rest of the day as we go about our lives and keep your spirit in our midst. It's your name, in your name that we pray. Amen.
This time I would like to see if you would join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you, Maggie. Today, we get ready to start up a new sermon series. The sermon series is, if you're Facebook friends with me, you kind of have an idea of where we're going. This has been a testimony. What you're getting ready to see is a video that is a testimony of a guy by the name of Bart Millard. He is the lead singer for a group called Mercy Me. And he gives a real life testimony of why he wrote the song, Even If. This is a story that for the last 2 years, I've sat down and analyzed this one testimony of wondering how in the world can we apply this to our everyday lives. And we've got a sermon series, I think it's probably, what, 5-6 weeks that we're going through, that we're going to break this down. Today we're going to be talking about, even if I feel like I want to give up. Because there's going to be times in our lives in which we are going to have those circumstances and those issues in our life that we say, you know what, I've had it. I just throw my hands up, I'm done. And I'm going to ask you to focus on those, because I'm going to ask you here in a few moments, what are some of those things that can keep us stuck? Some of those things in our life that will draw us further away from God because we just want to give up. As the ushers come forward today to take your offering, know that what you give today is going for the ministries and the missions, not only of this church, but of the community that God has placed us in. As the ushers come forward, I would love for you to pay attention to this video. It's about a 5-minute video that Bart talks about why he wrote this song.
It's interesting because when you stand up here, a lot of times people think you're supposed to have it all together. You have answers. We walk around hovering 2 inches off the ground, and God is good, you know, and all this kind of stuff. Man, that is not the case. There are some days where I don't want to stand up here, and I don't want to tell you that it's going to be okay because I don't believe it. Pardon my French, but sometimes life just sucks. Oh, that's what's happening for that, right? Amen, amen. It doesn't exist is wasting everybody's time. So this song was written like at the last minute, and I was having a bad day because, like I said, I have 5 kids. My oldest son, Sam, is 15. Sam was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes when he was 2 years old. And so if you know anything about chronic illnesses, you know what I mean when I say it never goes away. You have your good days and your bad days. You spend time in denial, but it's still there waiting on you. So this particular day, it didn't start off well. Probably some of my kids did. They wake me up early, it's not cool. I always blame my kids for my bad day. We had a checkup, like a 6-month checkup, and I don't even know if the checkup is good or bad, it doesn't matter. It's just a reminder that, hey, this thing is real and your life revolves around it. And then, so I leave there, it's like you're going to the principal's office. They could say, man, your kid is really healthy, but you're like, I could have done more, is what you feel like. And just beat you up. Well, then we're leaving there, we run into this dear friend of ours, this godly woman that starts asking, hey, tell me about diabetes. I don't know much about it. So we go through all of our statistics that we've memorized over the years, that Sam has had over 37,000 shots in his lifetime. Every time food goes in his mouth, a shot goes in his arm or leg. And so we're saying all this stuff, and she stops in the middle of it, and she goes, you know what? We're going to pray that God heals him. Now, hold on. Don't clap because it ticked me off. But my church, good little church face, smiled and said, God is good all the time. What I wanted to do is grab her by the shoulders and go, really? A healing for my son? Like, that's never crossed my mind for 13 years? What a novel concept. Because I was having a bad day. I blame my kids. Sometimes it's the last thing you want to hear because deep down, a part of me wrestles the fact that I know God can heal him, but for whatever reason, he's not. But you know what? That's okay. It's the way we see in our house, Sam's just going to change the world as a diabetic. And it's okay. And there are times when it doesn't feel okay, and I just want to be like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. I want to have the courage to stand in front of the fiery furnace and say, I know that God can deliver us, but even if he does not, I'm still not going to surrender. I'm still not going to bow because he's worth it. Because deep down, even though there are times I'll forget who I am, luckily he never forgets me. And there are times when I want to give up. But the bottom line is the only way I can get up every morning and go through this is because of what Christ has already done. No circumstance will change who I am in Christ. It'll try. Sometimes it feels like it's going to win. Regardless what we go through, he's bigger. We have to believe that with all of our hearts, or otherwise, what do we do? So I don't know what you're going through. I know that we all go through something. If you haven't yet, God bless you, it's coming. It's interesting, most of the people that I see that are standing in front of the fire, I have an aunt that has cancer, she gets it more than I do. Hair's almost gone. She looked at me and she said, do you think this is going to win? No. I won a long time ago. I'm like, how does she get it standing there and I'm just having a bad day and I'm struggling? So this song simply goes out to any of you fine people that have ever had a bad day. This is Even If.
See, sometimes you win some, sometimes you lose some. Thank you.
So where do you feel stuck in your life? Where do you feel like you want to give up? Give me some ideas, some information. Where is it that you feel like you just want to give up on situations, on circumstances? Where could we give up? Yeah. A parent with Alzheimer's. Yeah. Where else? Where else could we give up? Yeah. Chronic health issues. Yes. Where else? Yeah. The death of friends. Absolutely. Friends, loved ones. And here's the hard part. We can't explain it. We don't know how to explain death. We may even ask the questions, why? Why did this have to happen? Where else can we get stuck and want to give up? Marriage. Yeah. You can get stuck in a marriage. You want to give up. We want to just let it all go. I promise you that at the end of this, we will not all feel like we're Eeyore today. Okay? I'm promising you, when you leave here today, you're going to leave here with your hair on fire. Some of you, you go, wait a minute, I wish I would have hair to leave here on fire. You know? You're going to leave here with a hope. You're going to leave here because there's one particular word that Bart was talking about, and we're going to get to it here in just a second. Okay? Because it is rather, I love his testimony, and here's why I love his testimony. People look at other people and think, man, they've got their life in order. Everything looks great with them. I wish I could emulate their life because, man, I can tell that they have everything going right for them, which is totally not true sometimes. Sometimes every person, I would imagine that every person comes in here with at least one thing that is their kryptonite. It's something that they go to bed with each and every night going, wow, I wish I could have changed that, or I wish I could have done that differently. I wish that this pain would go away. And sometimes we may even say, I feel like just giving up. But here's the great part of this story. I'm going to be in Hebrews today. And Hebrews has, I always go back and think, man, was there anybody in life that had done this before I did it? Is there anybody in life that got stuck in life? And so I found this passage of Hebrews that I want to share with you. And we're going to be in Hebrews 12, but I'm going to back it all the way up to Hebrews 11. Because the author of this book really gave me insight. It's almost like, every once in a while God just drops that nugget on you and says, here you go. You want to preach about something? Here you go. Here's somebody that's been through this war and this battle before, and look at how they came out on the other side. So in Hebrews 11, in chapter 13, we're going to start there, verse 13. Each one of these people of faith died not yet having in hand what was promised, but still believing. How did they do it? They saw it way off in the distance, waved their greeting, and accepted the fact that they were transients in this world. Friends, we are transients in this world. This isn't our final destination. This isn't where we want to stop. There's something much bigger is where we're headed. We're just transients in this world. People who live this way make it plain that they're looking for their true home. If they were homesick for the old country, they could have gone back any time they wanted, but they were after a far better country than that, heaven country. You can see why God is so proud of them and has a city waiting for them. By faith, there's going to be a tricky word in here, and I'll see if you can catch it. Shouldn't be that hard, but we're going to see what we got. By faith, Abraham, at the time of testing, offered Isaac back to God. Acting in faith, he was as ready to return the promised son, his only son, as he had been to receive him. And this, after he had already been told, your descendants shall come from Isaac. Abraham figured that if God wanted to, he could raise the dead. In a sense, that's what happened when he received Isaac back, alive from off the altar. By an act of faith, Isaac reached into the future as he blessed Jacob and Esau. By an act of faith, Jacob, on his deathbed, blessed each of Joseph's sons in turn, blessing them with God's blessing, not his own, as he bowed worshipfully upon his staff. By an act of faith, Joseph, while dying, prophesied the exodus of Israel and made arrangements for his own burial. By an act of faith, anybody figure out what the word might be today? Oh, good! Oh, man, somebody's awake. This is awesome. By an act of faith, Moses' parents hid him away for 3 months after his birth. They saw the child's beauty and they braved the king's decree. By faith, Moses, when grown, refused the privileges of the Egyptian royal house. He chose a hard life with God's people rather than an opportunistic soft life of sin with the oppressors. He valued suffering in Messiah's camp far greater than Egyptian wealth because he was looking ahead, anticipating the payoff. By an act of faith, he turned his heel on Egypt, indifferent to the king's blind rage. He had his eye on the one no one can see and kept right on going. By an act of faith, he kept the Passover feast and sprinkled Passover blood on each house so that the destroyer of the firstborn wouldn't touch them. By an act of faith, Israel walked through the Red Sea on dry ground. The Egyptians tried it and drowned. By faith, the Israelites marched around the walls of Jericho for 7 days, and the walls fell flat. By an act of faith, Rahab, the Jericho harlot, welcomed the spies and escaped the destruction that came on those who refused to trust in God. I could go on and on, but I've run out of time. In other words, friends, there has been people that have gone through the same things that when we wake up each morning and go, why me? Why did this happen? And even if it has, how can I move on past it? How can I move on past a chronic illness? How can I move on past a marriage that hurts? How can I move on from parenting my children and thinking I'm not messing them up? How can I move on from parenting my mom and dad and think that I'm not messing up? How can I move on when a friend of mine is playing ball next to me one moment and is dead the next? How can I move on when someone crosses the center line and hits a tractor trailer head on, killing the entire car? Those are all circumstances that have happened in our area recently. How can I move on when I feel like I can't go on? How can I move on when people are trying to tell me that I'm something that I'm not and I'm really starting to believe what they're saying? And even if God is still there. In Bart's testimony, I love it that he says that people stand up here on stage, and I got with our band beforehand today. You know they get here at 7:30 in the morning, right? They get here well, and this just doesn't happen. They walk out of that room and start playing. And I got with the band this morning, and I said, you know, there's going to be times on a rainy morning such as today where we wish that we would have just stayed in bed. There's days in which a preacher will get up in front of somebody and say, I got nothing, God. You're going to have to give me something because I really don't have it today. And even if we move on from that, there's still the faith that as we stand in front of the fiery furnace, that God will give us what we need when we need it. So I move on to verse 12, chapter 12. Has anybody ever heard a great coach give a speech before a game? And you get all fired up. Or maybe you've heard a motivational speaker. Someone like Jimmy Valvano. How many of you know who Jimmy V is? Gave a great speech right before his death. Lou Gehrig. I wasn't born yet, but I know that some have. Know that the Lou Gehrig speech has been seen over and over and over again as a motivational speech for the disease that was named after him. How many of you seen Chris Farley? He's a motivational speaker. Matt Foley. I'm not going to dive on a chair or anything here in just a second, but I'm going to give you, you're going to hear these words that I'm getting ready to say to you, and you're going to leave here going, I have a hope. Say that with me. I have a hope. And it is God. Because even if He is still with me, no matter what I'm going through right now, no matter what the struggle is in my mind right now, He is with me. Here's the passage of Scripture because it fired me up when I first read it. I read from the Message Bible. It's Eugene Peterson's version. And if you get all psyched up as I did and you have to stand up and cheer this baby on, go right ahead. I'm giving you full permission. It said, do you see what this means? All these pioneers that I just spoke about who blazed the way, all these veterans cheering us on, it means we'd better get on with it. Things happen. Life happens. And sometimes we wonder why. And we get to the other side. And we don't know what's going to happen. Think about all these people. They were supposed to get to the promised land, but they didn't. Moses was supposed to get there, but then he died before he got there. Think of all the work that he put into it. Think of all the people on the other side that made it because of Moses. Strip down, start running, and never quit. Isn't it easy sometimes to quit when life gets hard? No extra spiritual fat, no parasitic sins. Keep your eyes on Jesus, who both began and finished this race we're in. Study how He did it, because He never lost sight of where He was headed. That exhilarating finish in and with God. He could put up with anything along the way. He could put up with the cross. He could put up with shame, whatever. And now, He's there. In the place of honor, right alongside God. When you find yourselves flagging in your faith because some days we say, we give up on God. And even if He is still there. There are churches around the world that are giving up spiritually on who God is. And even if He is still there. So when you find yourselves flagging in your faith, go over that story again, item by item. That long litany of hostility He plowed through. That will shoot adrenaline into your souls. That will shoot adrenaline into your souls. I don't know about you all, but I get pumped up to deliver the word. This adrenaline shoots through me. And when I saw that one word, that was the one word that turned me onto this whole passage of Scripture. Adrenaline. How many of us want to leave out of here thinking we left it all in worship to God today? Because even if we don't, He's still there tomorrow and the next day. And it's because of that. The cross. He battled through everything. He got ridiculed by people. He got spat on while He was carrying that for us. And He said, even if they don't feel like they're worth it, I still feel like they are. Whatever you are going through today in your situations, know that God is bigger. If we don't believe that, then why are we here? There's so many other things we could be doing on a Sunday morning. My friends, one year ago today, I stood in an office. Actually, I sat in an office with my wife, Catherine, and both my daughters, Megan and Faith. And our then district superintendent walked in a year ago today. And she proceeded to tell me, as she had told me the week before, she had told me on Monday, you're going to a different church. But I can't tell you where it is. How sick of a joke is that? I can't tell you unless I tell you in person, she said. I said, all right, because I was on a mission trip. That's the reason she couldn't tell me. I was under a house in Texas, pushing a pipe up underneath of the floor to a guy. And when I got the call, I said, you're going to have to hold the pipe. I got to take the boss's call. He goes, what? Hold the pipe. And he was holding the pipe. And I was gone for 5 minutes. And when he came back, he was still holding on for dear life to the pipe, going, dude, where'd you go? And I said, I'm back. See, because she told me you can't tell anybody. Another sick joke. And as we sat in that room a year ago today, she said, you're going to First Washington United Methodist Church. And the adrenaline began pumping through my veins. I don't know about those guys, but it was pumping through mine pretty well. And the reason this means so much to me is because even if I would have said, no, I don't feel like going, God was saying, tough, you're going. And I'm so glad and so thrilled that this is where God planted us. Because we could have said no. And then we would have missed out on the great opportunity of meeting you fine folks. Because that song that was played goes out to all of you who have ever had a bad day. God is with you. Even if you don't understand the why, even if it isn't what you want right now, even if you feel like, I wish it could be a different way, God is there with you, holding your hand. And if you don't believe me, all you have to do is look at the cross. Because that's where he paid the price for all of us.
You know, it's kind of crazy for me because I don't know what it is, but the past series and then this series, Troy has completely just spoke to me straight to my heart every single week. So, my takeaway from today is, it is, you have so many things that tell you that you're not good enough, that you're not going to go to heaven because of this, this, and this that's happened in your past, and it's so hard for you to look past those things and give them to God and let him take control, because we always try to hold on to that control. And I encourage you to give whatever you need to God, because he's always there. He's always present. He's always there for you to support you in whatever's going on, and to give that to God as anytime you have anything on your plate that you can't handle. So let's stand and let's sing together.
Heartbreak, isolation. Ooh, 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 ooh.
Okay, kid, you're coming with me. You're a great sermon illustration, is what you call it. So, if you didn't know it, Noella, as soon as the song started playing, started coming towards Jesus. I think that's what we all are called to do today. We live by faith, not by sight. And whatever is going on in our lives, we turn that over to God, and we live by faith. Right, kid? Right. She said right. I heard her. I heard her. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for giving us that opportunity to live by faith, not by sight, even if things seem to be going haywire in our lives. Lord, we just ask that you bless us this week, bless our families and friends this week, and may we be your light into this world. And it's in your name we pray, and all God's people said, amen.